Good morning, everybody. I'm Chris Schott from J.P. Morgan, and it's my pleasure to be introducing Teva today. From the company, we have Kåre Schultz, the company's President and CEO. After Kåre's presentation, we're going to go to our breakout session, which is in the Olympic Room around the corner. And with that, we'll turn it over to Kåre.
Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. We will be talking about the future, and in that connection, I will recommend you to take a look at this. I won't go through it, so we'll move to the next slide. No, it's a real pleasure to be here. It's 2 years ago that I was here for the first time as CEO of Teva, and I can see a few of you that were there. And back then, we had a pretty dramatic situation. We had a debt of $34 billion. We had Copaxone that had gone off patent and had generic competition in the U.S., and we had dramatic declining pricing in the U.S. generic space. We were basically facing a situation where we would lose roughly $5 billion in earnings over a two-year period, and that was the same as we were making in earnings. So that left kind of not very much to take care of the $34 billion in debt. So for that reason, 2 years ago, I announced that we were changing our strategy, and one of the key elements was a big restructuring where we were going to reduce the cost base significantly. At the same time, we were going to manage our debt, and of course, we were going to secure future growth, but that would come after the first restructuring period. Now, today, given the timing, I'm, of course, not going to talk about the actual results for last year. I can't do that now. You can come by on the call February 12th and hear more about that. But I'm going to give you an update on the broader picture, an update on where we are with three elements of the strategy. So the restructuring, the debt and the financing, and the future growth drivers. And what I hope to achieve is that all of you will see and realize that we've actually done the restructuring, that we have the debt and the refinancing in very good shape, and that we have a good prospect for future growth. But we can check that at the end to see whether my presentation worked. Now, the restructuring, as I said, the main purpose was to secure the earnings. And with the drop of $5 billion, we basically concluded that if we could take out $3 billion of the yearly spend base, then that would result in securing earnings of $3 billion, basically. That was the simple math behind it. Now, doing it, of course, was somewhat more complex. And you can see here some of the numbers that in the last 2 years, we've closed or divested 13 manufacturing sites completely. We're in the process of doing it for 10 sites, so they are being wound down or being up for sale. So that's an ongoing process. We've also closed a lot of labs and offices, about 40 labs and offices all over the world. In this connection, of course, we also had to say goodbye to a lot of good people. More than 12,000 people have left the company now. Some more will be leaving in connection with the last 10 manufacturing sites that we are winding down. Now, for a restructuring like this to work, you, of course, need to maintain your operational capabilities, because if you don't maintain that, then you are selling out the future and you won't have the growth in sales going forward that you need. Now, I'm happy to say that we've been able to do this major restructuring while maintaining, you could say, full operational capacity on all our different product lines. This is not because we should talk about the specifics of where these more than 60 sites that have been closed down are, but this is just to show that Teva is a very global organization. It has grown through acquisition of more than 20 companies over 20 years, and that, of course, has resulted in a very diverse geographical footprint with too many manufacturing sites, too many offices, and too many R&D locations. Now, we have optimized that a lot over the last 2 years. All these red crosses are either factories, offices, or labs that have been closed in that period. We are through most of it. It doesn't mean that we have completed it. We will continue optimizing the manufacturing footprint. Again, in connection with the full year earnings in February, we will give you a more precise picture of what the plans will be for the coming years in order to optimize the gross margin and the manufacturing setup. So more about that later. With regard to the debt situation, then, as I said, the debt was around $34 billion. And just a very brief recap for those of you who might not know, the reason for the debt was the acquisition of Actavis a major generic player, major player in the US generic space that was acquired by Teva, and for a price tag of roughly $40 billion, of which most of the money was borrowed in the bond market in the form of corporate bonds. Some of you might remember that about 2 years ago, a little less than 2 years ago, we did a refinancing that took out all the bank term loans and ensured that 100% of our debt was in corporate bonds. Now, what we've had to do over the last 2 years is, of course, to reduce the debt by, we have had some asset sales and we have had strong operational cash flow. And you can see that the debt is now approaching $25 billion. And our strategy is to continue to reduce debt. Basically, it's ironic I'm standing here because I don't like debt. I don't think companies in the pharmaceutical space should have a high leverage. I think that you should sort of probably be down to around 2 times net debt to EBITDA. We are right now above 5 times. There has, however, been one very good development, and that is because we've been stabilizing revenues, we've been stabilizing earnings the last 4 quarters. You'll see that in the 3rd quarter, for the first time, the net debt to EBITDA ratio has started to decline. And this will, of course, continue over the next many years as we use all our operational cash flow, free cash flow, to pay down debt and continue to do that. Now, when the $40 billion acquisition of Actavis was financed in the corporate bond market, the expectations for earnings were a lot higher than they are today. As I said, we are making roughly $3 billion, $2 billion roughly in cash flow. And the debt stacks, the maturities, were aligned with an expectation of maybe earning twice as much. That means that in some, and it's not very sort of smooth, so in some years the debt stacks that we repay are around the $2 billion, so that's not a problem. In some years they're higher. And we had a debt stack in 21 that was about, $4 billion. So we did a refinancing exercise just recently, 4th quarter last year, where we refinanced about $2 billion, basically moving the maturity from 21 out to 25. And including that refinancing, we now have liquidity and we have operational cash flow expectations. That means for the next 3 years, we won't have the need to do that. So the next 3 years, we're just reducing net debt every year on a steady basis. Then 3 years from now, there's another debt stack of around $4 billion. So we'll need to do another refinancing of around $2 billion. Hopefully by then, the credit rating has improved and we can borrow it even cheaper than what we managed to do this 4th quarter, where we still had a very good reception in the credit market. It was heavily oversubscribed and we had no problem with the refinancing that we had to do. And of course, it will help that the net debt to EBITDA ratio will continue to decline. But of course, it's not enough for us to get the situation under control. If you want to think about it conceptually, then the last 2 years we've spent getting things under control in the sense that we got the cost base under control. We did the crude optimization of manufacturing. We're going to optimize more, but it's more sophisticated now. It's not just shutting down things. It's optimizing what we do. But all that doesn't help anything if you're not getting back to growth on your revenues, of course. And there's been 2 dramatic drags on growth. One is Copaxone, that used to be a $4 billion-plus product. Now it's down to around, a $1 billion-plus product. And it's still declining, but a lot less, of course, in absolute terms. And then there was the problem I mentioned before, that U.S. generics basically imploded, and the value of U.S. generics came down to basically half of what it used to be. Now, there's an irony in this, because the irony is that we and the whole business, whether it's specialty pharmaceuticals or generics, are, of course, being accused in all the media of too high pricing and, you know, taking advantage of patients with too high prices. Now, the hard facts of the generic industry in the U.S. is that it's actually the opposite that's taking place. The annual saving from generics and biosimilars in the U.S. is around $300 billion. Teva alone supplies products with an annual saving of around $43 billion. So the idea that generics are not sort of helping make pharmaceuticals and medicines affordable is basically flawed and not correct. You can see here some of the products. Some of them have been a little bit in the media. You know that generic EpiPen has been a big story, also related to pricing of EpiPen. We are very happy to say that we are now providing generic EpiPen and EpiPen Junior to anybody who needs it at an affordable price. It's also very interesting that we are now getting more into the biosimilar space. You can see here a label called Truxima. That's a biosimilar product to Rituxan, which we launched in November. And I've said many times that biosimilars in the U.S. so far have underpenetrated, most likely due to lack of understanding of the whole commercial setup and what it takes to penetrate in the U.S. marketplace due to the complexity of rebating and contracting and so on. We believe, being the biggest volume supplier of pharmaceuticals in the U.S., that we know basically everybody that we need to know. We know how to do the contracting, the rebating. And we can see now, with the launch of Truxima, that we know how to obtain a good share in biosimilars. I said at the previous third quarter announcement that we were aiming for double-digit share in this marketplace and sustainable profitability. So we are not trying to take over everything, but we wanted a fair share of the market at a reasonable profitability. And I think that's exactly what we're going to prove with Truxima and future biosimilar launches. So all that being said, there's a strong future, the way I see it, for both traditional generics and biosimilars in the U.S. marketplace. And the pricing has now stabilized. This death spiral to the bottom, which got ignited by FDA approving more ANDAs and by Indian and Chinese players getting into the marketplace, that has all stabilized. So now we have a stable supply-demand situation working to the benefit of patients and the manufacturers. Now, in Europe, the situation has been more calm. We haven't discussed it so much, but it's interesting to conclude that the percentage of pharmaceuticals in Europe that are generics is increasing, and that there's low single-digit growth in European generics and also in the OTC space. So we have a very stable, solid business, and we're still churning out, you know, hundreds of launches every year. In the U.S. alone, more than 40 new generics were launched from us last year. In Europe, it's more than that. So it's a very stable and steady business. And actually, I've said many times that with the reduction in our cost, Teva Europe has never made as much money as it did in 19 and will make even more money in 2020. So that looks really nice for the future. Then a country we haven't talked so much about is China. And I once had a colleague who said that Teva, I rephrase, Teva has successfully retained an opportunity in China by basically never doing anything. So that means, since this is the second largest pharma market in the world, it makes a lot of sense to do something. Now, it's no secret that I'm not a strong believer in joint ventures in these kind of markets, so we've decided to do it organically. And we've had the luck that the Chinese government have realized that certain products have never been launched in China. So the government has made a list, it's publicly available, of pharmaceuticals that they would like to have in the Chinese market, where nobody ever wanted to spend the money doing the phase 3 trials and the whole very, very long regulatory process in China. It turns out that because we do so many products, we do some of these products as well. So we've just launched Treanda in China. We have Austedo that has been filed. And the benefit here is we can do that without doing any trials in China, because the Chinese authorities have realized they would like to have these products in the marketplace to the benefit of patients. So we've just filed Austedo, and we think we'll get that approval within this year. So that means that we're slowly building up. These are not big numbers today, but these are, you know, 100% controlled numbers from our side. We don't have a partner that's controlling things, and we will be growing very big in terms of percentages, but from a small base. But it will be profitable the whole way through, and in 5-10 years, China hopefully will be a significant part of our business. Now, the key drag on the specialty side has, of course, been the patent expiry of Copaxone, with a drag of some, by now, maybe $3 billion, and in the coming years, a lot less, some hundreds of millions reduced sales. In order to get the whole business growing, then you could say, very simplistically speaking, the drag from Copaxone has to be less than the growth from new specialty products, assuming that the overall generic business is growing low single digit. And the way to do that is, of course, to grow the two new products we have in our portfolio, which are Austedo, which is used for in Huntington's disease, for movement disorder there, and in tardive dyskinesia, which is these very severe, you would say, tics that people get, which are debilitating from them. They can't work well in the workplace. They can't function well socially because of tardive dyskinesia. Now, Austedo is the first product, together with one competitor, ever approved to treat tardive dyskinesia. Right now, we see very strong growth for the second year in a row for Austedo. We are starting to launch it in other markets. I just told you about China. And we expect to see this product continue to grow for a long period. The reason is very simple. It's targeting tardive dyskinesia, Huntington's. The penetration in tardive dyskinesia is very, very low due to the fact that there was never any effective therapy. There's probably around 500,000 Americans suffering from tardive dyskinesia. Today, we have around 10,000 patients in total on both Huntington's disease and tardive dyskinesia. So a huge potential for this product. The guidance we gave for this year was 350 million, and we will surely surpass that, as we have also indicated early on. So a very strong growth driver for the coming years will be Austedo. The other strong growth driver is the new class of drugs, where Ajovy is one out of three, which is a phenomenal new therapy for migraine. There's been no real new therapy for migraine for more than 20 years. This therapy, which is a biologic, a monoclonal antibody, improves migraine for people with chronic migraine dramatically. On average, it takes your number of migraine days down by 50%. But some people even lose the migraine completely. Our clinical profile is second to none. It is as good as competition. We don't have any safety problems whatsoever. One competitive product has a slight problem. And we see very strong penetration in this class. We have a little short-term issue that we are up against two competitors who have auto-injectors. We have a really, really nice auto-injector, which has been approved in Europe. But we're still waiting for the FDA approval. Should be here any day. But to be fully competitive in this space, we, of course, also need a nice auto-injector, because this is a product you inject yourself once a month, or in our case, you can also do it once a quarter. We firmly believe that the product profile we have will make us very competitive, and we estimate that we can get around 25% share of this market long term. Right now, we are slightly below 20% share of the market due to the lack of competitiveness on our device. But within the next coming months, we expect to level that playing field and be very competitive also in the migraine space. In Europe, the launches are coming along nicely. You know that it's a country-by-country thing in Europe. We've launched in 5-6 countries by now, and we'll continue to do so in the coming years. So all in all, I'm predicting that the growth from Austedo and Ajovy combined will now, in the coming years, be higher than the decline from Copaxone, all leading to good future growth prospects for our top line. So what I think I have proven to you is that we've done the restructuring. We've done exactly what we promised to do. We promised to reduce the spend base with $3 billion, everything included. It was $16.3 billion in 2017. It has to be less than $13.3 in 2019, and I can promise you that's the case. We've also handled the debt nicely, taking it down more than $8 billion over 2 years, and we'll continue to do so. And that means, of course, our ratios on the debt side will continue to improve over the coming years. And we also now have a situation where the drag versus the growth is looking positive. So we're expecting to see low revenue growth in 2020, and then, of course, higher once we get into the future, simply because of the fact that the drag from Copaxone disappears more or less, while we still see Austedo and Ajovy growing, and while we see the combination of U.S. generics and biosimilars also having a very stable to positive outlook. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank you all for listening. It was a pleasure to present to you, and if you're interested in asking questions, then we will now move to the Olympic. room where we will be taking questions. Thank you for coming.